There is a change in my presentation today. I'm going to present, because most people don't know our early history of the company, what actually happened. It's 10 minutes, 15 minutes. I actually do happen to have all our founders here, most of them, so I want to introduce them. Because there is one thing that has always bothered me about this company, one thing that when the press article appears, I never read the press about myself, honestly. One reason is I always felt I get too much credit for lots of things. No, the company's history is a lot more interesting than that. So I actually want to talk about that today first before I start my actual session. It'll be about 10, 15 minutes. I'm going to introduce our founders and tell the early days, almost the prehistory, the history of what actually, how this thing came to be. And this presentation itself is made using our short time. And I'm using this iPhone to actually control the presentation. You go to our attend.zoho.com. You can go on your phone or your thing or on the app. And yeah, the audience key is Zoho, if you can read it there. So that's how we always present these days. This is not yet publicly launched, the software. We are using it internally now, testing. So that's the instruction. So visit this link or using the app, both will work. So this presentation I'm going to talk about, as I said, the first 10 minutes. Really, it's going to be about the early history of Zoho Corp. And this presentation actually deliberately, you'll see it's unadorned. It's the old PowerPoint style. That used to be how we used to present maybe 10 years ago. It's also to tell you how much the company has evolved. And just to give you, my brother Kumar is here. Kumar, please come on stage. He was so much instrumental in a lot of things that happened in our early days. He and I were working in Qualcomm as engineers. I was actually a wireless DSP engineer. My job was to invent the DSP algorithms that go into CDMA. In fact, that was about the time CDMA had got standardized. We were starting to think about something like 3G, actually. LTE had happened about, the very early invention for LTE was made around the time I was there. Even though I didn't work on that directly, I worked on the CDMA part. So that was the time, it was 95. So today, of course, you have 3G, LTE, all that in the market. It's amazing to see how far it came. And at that time, you have to remember, Qualcomm was in fact, it's interesting, Qualcomm was about the same size as Zoho is today, both in revenue and headcount, when we were engineers at that time. And it had a lot of promise, but there were lots of people who said CDMA will never work. It will never possibly ever work. So that's actually something useful to remember, because I was working as an engineer on technologies where press will write an article saying it is snake oil, it will never work. I used to remember reading those things, actually. And anyway, Kumar was a software engineer and I was a DSP engineer. And our other brother had just started his PhD at the University of Rochester. And we would talk about, Kumar and I would talk about, a lot about something is happening in India. And we also would feel we'll go shopping, we'll see there'll be made in Taiwan, made in China, made in Korea. There won't be any made in India. You will not find any made in India in any American store ever. So think, why is this? I mean, why are we so a billion people? We can't make anything. I mean, is this all it is that we could sell anywhere? This was definitely a thing that we would feel, because you go shopping in anywhere, Costco, Walmart, anywhere, you will find that there's not much made in India. Actually, it has changed. I mean, there is a lot more that's made in India these days. Anyway, Kumar would argue with me that software is the way to go if you want to do anything in India. In 95, I think there was an excellent call, if you think about it. So I actually didn't know software. In fact, the very first, I remember Kumar installed Linux on our home PC. I mean, in 95 itself, we decided Windows is shit. Okay, so you would install Linux. And at that time, you had to actually compile the drivers You have to do all that. It is not like today. So he was compiling the drivers. He found the SCSI device driver. And then asked him, what are you doing? Explain it to me. And I didn't know what a device driver was. I didn't know what a kernel was. I mean, I'm a wireless DSP engineer. I had no idea of all this. So he would patiently explain all this. And he was the one who would tell me, you know, you have to get into software. Then in November 95, he returned to India to essentially what was a maybe dinner table conversation about 6 months turned into action. You know. And Shekhar saw this and said, okay, I'm coming with you. He came and then maybe just a week, 10 days, I remember, I drove both of them to the airport. I drove him to the airport and then a week later I drove him to the airport. So that's how it was. And then Shekhar persuaded Shailesh, who came on board. And they set up this company called Vembu Systems. And what is interesting now is that company also actually exists now. It's an interesting history. And then there's another parallel thread was going on around the same time, which kind of joined together later. Tony Thomas was one of my close friends. He was actually 3 years senior to me in IIT Madras. He and I shared a lot of common friends, and he worked in Bell Labs. I was in Princeton, so we were nearby. We were not that far. So in those days, we would meet up in a Diwali function or something. It was more social. In 95, he started writing code in Java, which was the new thing at that time. And he published this humble little, maybe 1 MB download. I think 1 MB it was, in this advanet.com domain. And his friend Srinivas joined him at the time, and they created this entity called Advent Network Management. It was a little, Srinivas? Where's Srinivas? So this was how things looked in 96. There's one thing you notice, I was not in the picture here. I was not involved in these things at that time. Then we had this Advent Network Management. This was Tony and Srinivas. And Tony could not be here. He would love to be here. He's a very close friend of mine. He comes to every event in US. He could not be here. He had a surgery. So. And India, Kumar, and Shekhar did this. And it was only in 96, there was a few months after all this, I moved to Silicon Valley. And the goal was, well, let's try to find some market, what to do. And in 96, Tony's, this SNMP API got some interest from developers. People wanted to use it for building apps on top. It was a little library. And then I was the one who made this connection between what Kumar was doing and what Tony was doing there. These guys were doing the India team. And Tony said, hey, can you help me with this? Then these guys started writing code, additional product, additional support. And then in May 97 is when I got really involved in this. I started to, until then it was, code was happening, there was not much. There was no money, you have to remember, this is all pre-money, as I say. People sitting and coding and not much going on. Kumar had found a way to, he was doing some contract work in Chennai, he had found a way to pay the bills, but there wasn't much to go around anyway. There was savings, all that. But then I started to sell the software, and so I went to our local Office Depot store and printed a business card for $15. My title at the time was VP of Marketing and Business Development. I thought actually that's what you call yourself, you want to be selling. That was my idea at the time. So that was my first creative idea. So I actually even almost thought, let's see if people believe it. Whether if I give the card, people believe it. Actually, people believed it. That was the fun part. So the software was started selling almost in spite of I'm a lousy salesman. In fact, true story, this was in 98. I sold the software for $30,000 to a big OEM customer. And the guy who's decision maker, director of network management, his title, we signed the contract, and he later called me and said, you should hire, he's Indian, you should hire a real salesman. I asked him why. You should have asked me $300,000 for this. You are an idiot. He said, you are an idiot. So go hire a salesman. He told me that. Actually, that is a true story. In fact, we did end up hiring a salesman about 6 months after that. So my actual attempting to sell by myself, kind of, I mean, complimented by other better people than myself. And the 98, Tony and Srini was also moved to Silicon Valley because at that time we had this, the networking boom was starting, the whole, you know, that was when Cisco started acquiring companies right and left, all of that. And we said, oh man, we have a, suddenly there is some interest in our software. So we changed the name of the company after the domain, AdvaNet. And then the Indian company at that time became AdvaNet India. That is how, that's when it got formalized. This was probably in 98. Until then it was a, we were selling, but it wasn't completely formalized. It wasn't very clear which entity was selling, you know. It was weird, interestingly. And then the next 2 years were like a bubble, you know. In bubble times, if you hit something, we happened to be the picks and shovels guys to the gold miners. That's how I say it. The networking boom was on. In Silicon Valley itself, this is interesting history to remember. We will allude to this later because there is a bubble now, okay? So you have to remember bubbles because what happens in bubbles and what happens in the bust are very, very unconnected. There were 300 optical networking companies in Silicon Valley at that time. I'm not exaggerating. I personally have visited, I used to visit 150 of them to sell. I mean, at that point I had become a, you know, sales engineer, and I had another salesman who was the one who asked for the money. You know, you have to have a guy who asks for the money without being shy. So I had a salesman with me, and I was a sales engineer. That's how it was. We sold maybe 150 OEMs at that time. We actually became a standard. In fact, our product became a standard in that micro, small niche. And Tony saw me, you know, I'll go and I'll present, and my job was to persuade the customer. And the sales guy's job was to collect the money. That's how we had divided up the responsibility. And these guys all would create the product, from Tony to Kumar, Srinivas, all of them were the product experts at the time, and Sailesh, all of them. So Tony said, you are the visible face. You are the one going and persuading people. You should become the CEO. And I said, no, I'm actually not. I don't think I'm really ready. I don't think I want to do that job. I'm not good at this. But in 2000, it was kind of, I became the CEO by almost, you know, by being nominated for it. Then in 2001 to 2003 was the mirror image of the bubble, the bust. Even in 2000, I thought that, you know, all these guys are doing the same thing. How could 300 of them survive? But I thought maybe 50% of them won't survive, right? That's what I thought. But actually, 1% of them survived. 1% of them survived. It is shocking, absolutely shocking what happened. I witnessed it firsthand. We had sold to like these 150 companies, and one by one, in fact, the way I'll know is I'll get the customer I sold to will send me a resume saying, hey, our company shut down, lost my job. Sometimes the customer who didn't pick us also will send the resume. This is even weird. So I'd go in, sometimes the customer wouldn't have bought, 6 months later I get a resume. Not that we could hire, because our customers are dying. The market just evaporated. The 2002 time, I remember, I'd go to work, I mean, go to office, there's nothing to do. There's nothing to do because your software you've written actually has no real market anymore. It's barely, most of your customers have vanished. You know, once the company is very stagnant, you have nowhere to go. You have lots of different ideas. People don't agree with each other. That's what happened. It's always happened. So, and then we had people branch out. Shekhar, Tony, Kumar, and that order. Srinivas all branched out. And here today, this is the nice thing. All of them, each has a company. This is Kumar, that is Shekhar, Tony here, and Srinivas. These two are Bangalore, those two are Chennai. So these four startups have born. They're all actually multi-million dollar revenue now. They're all doing well. They're all product companies. So it's very interesting what happened after that. This is all the, you can say almost the Zoho derivative later came. So. And the company then, we completely reinvented ourselves. There was Manage Engine. We decided to take our telecommunication software, reinvent as Manage Engine. That's what we did. And then in 2005 is when we launched Zoho, October. And by then we had become a lot of experiments were going on. Because when you had people, but you didn't have any market, you just decided to perform experiments. That's what we did. We did a lot of experimentation and we found some paths. We actually launched several other things that failed. You only know the ones that succeeded, but there were lots of other initiatives that failed. But I'm actually proud of them too. I don't worry about failure. So ManageEngine is now actually the leading player in that market. We could be public just as ManageEngine, by the way. That's how big that is now. We could be public just as Zoho. That's also grown quite big. So there's actually two public companies in Zoho if you wanted to take this public. And then in early 2009, we finally, it became kind of painful because AdvaNet was not the company name. Then we had ManageEngine, we are selling, we have Zoho. The press articles became confusing. The guy will ask, what is the name of the company? Brand confusion, as they say. So we said, Zoho Corp, that's the name. That's the sexy name, we're going to keep it. So that's, and it also, we made a major decision. All along, the company developed everything in India. All the products, everything was India. After the first bit of code Tony wrote, after that, everything was done in India. And by 2009, it became obvious that it's actually an Indian company. And we had this Silicon Valley thing that we were claiming Pleasanton. So we just moved the whole actual incorporation to India too. That happened in 2009. Because I felt the company has to be true to what it is. Not some what it is not. So we became, that's how it happened. And I want to make it very clear in this, I get too much credit. You have to remember the very first code, the very first product. If Tony hadn't written that code, I don't know if this company would have existed. So honestly, if Kumar and Shekhar did not return to India, we don't have this Zoho actually. What? In fact, it goes more than that. Kumar and Shekhar personally hired the first 300, actually 400 people almost. And in fact, one of the speakers, Sridhar Iyengar today, was the very first person Kumar hired personally. Sridhar, are you here? Yeah, stand up. So he's the very first person who was hired. That's also something it tells you about Zoho. We actually tend to retain people. We tend to hold on to our people. And in fact, over 90%, 95% of the managers in our company today, people who manage all the products, everything, came from who they hired. Kumar hired and Shekhar hired and Silesh managed. And all along, Silesh has been my partner in crime in running the engineering. He is, in all these, somebody has to be a public face. And I'm happy to serve the role, but it also, I'm fully aware that it's without all of them, it would not have happened. Absolutely would not have happened. So that's what we wanted to talk about this, because this is very appropriate for India in particular, because we have to know our roots, where we come from. So thank you.